everyone. My name is Lenja Slierendrecht and I'm very happy to welcome you here on behalf of Studium Generale here at the Paviljoen for the lecture Why Do We Work So Hard by Professor Dr. Govert Buijs. Govert Buijs is an endowed professor of political philosophy at the VU Amsterdam and Christian philosophy here at Erasmus. His research comprises the relationship between moral markets and the possibilities to humanize the economy. This lecture here today is part of the nationwide series called The Future of Market Economy, and it will therefore be recorded. This series investigates how a free market can be organized in which economic growth is no longer a central goal. Give him a warm applause, Professor Govert Buijs.
Thank you for this welcome, and thank you for the invitation to give this lecture here this afternoon. And thank you all for coming. Let me just start with a little warning. The title, Why Do We Work So Hard, may easily cause some confusion. I have sometimes been giving this talk for a lecture hall who are kind of expecting to give all kind of tips against burnout. Yes. Oh well, can you help me in all these kind of some psychological problems? Of course, that can be the case. So, but that is not what I'm going to talk about. So, although it may help a little bit, I don't know. But that is not the point of this lecture. It's more about thinking about the future of our economy, and therefore the title "Joyful Economy of Towards an Economy of Joy" is kind of more appropriate. But sometimes. Publishers, they're looking for a good title that sells, and that was the background why they chose this title, Waarom Werken We Zo Hard? Why Do We Work So Hard? This has been published recently, this book, and another book that is kind of connected to this, I just mentioned this, is Het Goede Leven en de Vrije Markt, which I wrote with two colleagues, if you have brothers, sisters, or children, I don't know, who are taking right now at the VWO at high school the philosophy track, then they will have to do their exam on this book actually this year. So we will see how that goes actually. So yeah. Okay, what I'm going to do this afternoon? Well, I would like to start with a bit of anthropology. Thinking about what is a human being actually, and why I'm doing that is actually to ask, well, actually, why do we have an economy in the first place, and why don't animals have an economy? If we succeed in that part and we can kind of find out why we do have an economy, we can as well then use that later on as a kind of yardstick to see, well, what has become of this in the course of history. Are we doing okay in terms of our anthropology? Or is there a mismatch between who we are as human beings and our economy? And maybe a mismatch. Well, actually, that's what I'm going to argue, actually, that there have been, and still in different forms, are mismatches between who we are as human beings and what we have organized, that we then can call an economy. So that is a kind of sometimes a little bit of sad story that I'm going to tell. And today, when you are giving lectures at universities, then you have to give trigger warnings. So this is a trigger warning that when sometimes something happens or something is talked about but it's not really fun and maybe kind of give you some emotions maybe stirred up there of sadness, then I give this warning that will be the case. So if you want to leave before that, then you are free to do that, but don't sue me afterwards. Yeah, that is the idea. So. Sad, but there is as well some encouraging developments as well that I will be talking about. Then kind of depressing part will be that I will talk about the burnout society. in a more encompassing way than simply about the psychological problems, but that will be part of it. And then a short reflections on the way to go, the future, redirecting capitalism. That is kind of the outline of the lecture that I'm going to give. So usually when we say, why do we work, why do we have an economy? And people easily say, well, yeah, we need bread, yes. And in Dutch we say brood op de plank. Well, that's just what you see here. And if I would have you in class and you would write that down on your exam sheet, we need to have bread, then I would say, well, I don't think that that is right, that that is the correct answer, yes. We really don't need bread, yes. We need calories, that is sugar. And we need water, yes, we need liquids, but that's what we need. But bread is something that is totally, you can say, superfluous. We don't need it. We are kind of already, and that's what apparently we are doing as human beings. We take the corn and we are going to bake this bread, all kind of difficult procedures that we are going through. That in essence are not necessary. And easily when you compare us with animals, then you will immediately see that it is totally unnecessary, yes? And even unlikely, yes? This is a little song. I don't know whether it is in English there too, but in Dutch it is, ik zag twee beren broodjes smeren, I once saw two bears buttering their bread. And then the song continues that was a miracle, yes? Was even a hyper miracle, yes, a miracle above miracle, wonder boven wonder, because big bears don't do this, yes, and we know that, of course, yes, it is totally, and they are right, it is useless to do this, yes, and you can see, for example, you can use other animals there as an example, lion eating an antelope or a deer or a stag, I don't know what it exactly is. But then you see, well, that's how easy actually it is to get calories. Yeah, you just take it and you eat it. You don't do it on the barbecue. No salt, no pepper there. It is just you eat it, and that's what's necessary. Indeed, that is our biological existence that we need, and that's how you do it as a lion. Yes, but we as human beings, we make much more. Yes, we have. In Britain, you have this program, the great British Bake Off, and we have here Heel Holland Bakt. The entire world is baking, etc. But it is unnecessary. So, and that has been for a long time recognized in history, that we are doing things that animals don't do. There is in the New Testament a saying of Jesus, in which he said, look at the birds. They fly around in the sky, and they don't sow and they don't reap, no harvest. They don't mow. They are clothed by God, by the Heavenly Father, just without a Jew. Yes. And they are already way ahead of us. And they may be even much more beautiful, says Jesus, than Queen Maxima. Well, he was not quite saying Queen Maxima. He was saying Queen King Solomon, but just to get the more kind of contemporary slide to it, you could say Queen Maxima. And then you say, well, Jesus was probably not right in that. Yes, I don't think that the birds are more nicer than Queen Maxima or King Solomon. But well, it all depends on what you compare it with. Jesus may be winning after all there, photo finish, but this is really, really beautiful there. Yes. Without anything that they have done for it. Yes. They are just so from, they grow up and look at us. We need to have clothing. What a poor creatures we are actually, and that is really, if we look at human beings, and biologists have in the 20th century been talking about this quite extensively. They talked about human beings as mangelwesen, as beings with an inherent shortages, we have, well, quite badly developed instincts compared to animals. Yes. Indeed, we don't have a fur, we need to clothe ourselves, we need all kind of things. And that has been, there's an old, I just talked about Jesus talking about this, but this in Plato you will find the story, that's an old Greek myth about Prometheus and Epimetheus, two brothers, half gods, who were assigned by the gods to give attributes to living beings. Yes. And then all kinds of living beings came there and they gave strength to the lion and speed to a cheetah and wings to the birds to fly, etc. So all kind of attributes were given by one of the brothers, Epimetheus. And then even almost at the end, there was still another creature was coming there, and Epimetheus was looking in his large bag there and looking for attributes to give to that creature. And then he said, well, I'm lost. I'm out of attributes. I don't have anything to give to this creature. And his brother became angry with him, Prometheus, said, well, how could you do this? You should have watched what you still had to do, who was still on the waiting list. And now you have here this creature, and you don't have anything to give it. Yes? No fur, no instincts, no skills to survive. Yeah, this it couldn't warm itself, keep itself warm. So, well, then Prometheus, that had been a very old myth, he decided, well, we cannot let this creature, and of course, dead by the human beings, we cannot let it go and live like this, just without anything, yes. And then he went to the gods and stole their two things, actually. He stole their fire so that they could, I think the next slide has it there. Here is Prometheus stealing the fire and giving it to the human beings so that they could warm itself and they could use it as well for, making iron, etc., these kind of things. And he gave creative skills. Divine skills, actually, the crafts, arts and crafts he gave there. Yes. And our helplessness, I just mentioned, has been noticed by, in this old myth, as well by philosophers, quite unknown, but very interesting philosopher, who was the mayor of the city of Emden in the early 17th century. And he had this beautiful quote with which he started his book on politics. Well, truly, in living this life, no man is self-sufficient or adequately endowed by nature. Yes, here we are, poor. Yes. For when he is born, destitute of all help, naked and defenseless, as if having lost all his goods in a shipwreck, he is cast forth into the hardships of this life, not able by his own efforts to reach a maternal breast, nor to endure the harshness of his condition, nor even to move himself from the place where he was cast forth. By his weeping and tears, he can initiate nothing except the most miserable life, a very certain sign of pressing and immediate misfortune. Bereft of all counsel and aid, for which nevertheless he is then in greatest need, he is unable to help himself without the intervention and assistance of another. This is a description of our baby. And of course, we love our babies, and we are really fond of them when they are there in the when we keep them in take them in our arms, etc. But it is really miserable. It's compared to say young horses, when they come to, within an hour they can walk and go with the group, and a lot of animals. And by the way, getting to grow up as an animal, usually, well, this lion that we were talking about earlier, 1.5 years, then he can do everything that a lion has to do in life. And then he can hunt for its own antelope or deer, etc. And so then he is complete. And when we are 1.5 years old, well, I don't know, but you can remember, you cannot remember your own life, one and a half year, even that you cannot remember. But if you look at others, one and a half year, well, that is not much really, that is not much really. Yes. We are helpless human beings. Yes. However, our helplessness, and I told you, we have different things, almost divine characteristics from, given by Prometheus. And here you see already that it is something that is, yeah, the case with Homo sapiens, but already earlier with earlier hominids in the evolution. This is what you here see is probably the oldest, yeah, thing in which we see traces of human beings doing something that animals never will do. They kind of have made a kind of pattern here. Yes, they kind of have an ornamentation. You will see here the lines, yeah, on the shell, which apparently has something, well, yeah, something creative. Yes. We make something, we ornamentation, yeah, versiering in Dutch, and we don't know the exact meaning of this, but apparently even with the before Homo sapiens, already hominids, are doing this kind of thing 450,000 years ago. And yeah, when we are talking about Homo sapiens, then fully, you see, he's creating all kind of artifacts. 30,000 years before Christ, you see, yeah, probably this is a small female figure, probably something, a divine symbol of fertility. And here something perhaps of male power. We don't know exactly what has been the meaning of it, but that's what human beings apparently are doing. So apparently, indeed we are a helpless being, but we kind of do other things, we compensate it. And that was what Prometheus was talking about, fire and art and crafts. Yes. And here you see, you may have been there in Lascaux in France, beautiful cave paintings there of horses and cows and bisons, and very impressive actually. Deer. So our helplessness is kind of compensated by our creativity. And yet, and just let me do a small experiment here, because with our creativity something strange is really the case. And we are here with a group of, say, well, are we 60, 70 people? I don't know. Well, and I don't know. Who of you? And it may not be that you say, well, I don't expect here that here people here now in the afternoon who are playing in the Concertgebouw Orchestra. That I don't, maybe, you never know, but I don't expect this. Just on statistical reasons only already. But maybe that some people will say, well, I'm a certain instruments, piano or flute or fagot or whatever. I play, well, I like to play guitar or drum or it may not be brilliant, but I enjoy this really. I'm, who wants to stand up and say, well, I'm playing in this kind of instrument, musical instrument. Who wants to stand up? One, two, three, or hand, raise hand, can you, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Yeah, okay. Yeah, well, about, say, 10, 15 people there in this group of 70. Well, that is, it's a nice average, actually. That's a nice average. That's interesting. Other question. Who, if you say, well, okay, I may not have built my own house, that may be too much. But when there is something to do in the house, do some painting, a new floor that needs to be there, or do some other, small repair, etc. Well, I don't have two left hands, I can do that. I can manage. Who wants to, please stand up. Or raise your hands. Yeah, quite a few. More. More craftsmen than the musicians here. Okay, that's great. Yes. Now a third one. If you say, well, that comes now, and I think earlier on it was in April 1st. Now I think it is, well, I believe it is May 1st. Then we all have to fill in tax forms. And who says, well, okay, leuker kunnen we niet maken, it may not be nice, but I'm good at it. I'm good at figures here. Who in Rotterdam, this economic university, who said, well, I'm pretty, pretty good at this, at tax forums and so on. Don't be too much humility here. Yeah. Okay. Well, say about 15 people again. Yeah. Who has put up his hands twice? 1, 2, 3. About 10 people. Who? 3 times. You have just been watching a miracle. Some people do exist. Do miracles exist? Yes, miracles do exist. Yes. Why? Because, well, if you would go to the lion that I just showed you, and you have a kind of herd of lions, and you ask them, who of you is able to catch an antelope? And then they will all rise as one and say, well, I. And if you then later you say, well, then there's just down the road there may be a couple of beavers maybe there and building a dam. Yes. And then you will ask the beavers, who of you can build a dam? Say, oh, I can. We can. Yes. And if you then go back to the lions and ask them, down the road there are some beavers there building a dam, and they really need a hand. Can you give them a hand? Yes. And the lions will say, we have 2 left hands. We cannot do this. And if you ask the beavers, well, can you assist with catching an animal? You have the same story. They cannot do this. Yes. And what is now happening with human beings is that they have different skills. They have very different skills. And they look pretty much the same at first. But when you are asking you to raise your hand and say, well, some have musical gifts, others have all kind of different gifts. Yes, and that is already in this old myth of Epimetheus and Prometheus, when Prometheus steals these arts and crafts of the gods, yes, then he kind of throws it around among the human beings. Yes, and some catch this one and some catch the other one. And so there is a difference between human beings in what they can do. Yes. And the difference between individual human beings is much larger than between different animals. Yes. So our creativity is very important to know, just on the side, if you are a manager or are about to become a manager, yes, then crucial thing is that you know that that creativity is a plural thing, yes, and that we are not talking about creativity that everybody has the same abilities. No, the people are different, yes, and what managing is nothing else than saying, then connecting the people, who is there, that person can do this and that person can do that, and you have to organize this so that people can assist each other, yes, and then you get a team. Yes. I just showed you this, that even when we already we are talking about these cave paintings, this probably must have been the case that it was plural among them as well. We cannot imagine that in this the tribe that was making these paintings, that everybody was just taking turns and making these beautiful animals. That is highly unlikely. And we have one small proof of this. That is the only drawing of a human being that has been that we find in Lascaux, and you will find that here. Yes, that you say, well, compared to how these drawings are, this is pretty poor, isn't it? So probably someone was drawing that who really did not master the skill of drawing very well. So, and therefore, said, well, stop. This is just the only thing to do, and please do something else. They have probably said to him, yes, and so that's very important. This creativity of human beings is plural, yes? So the plural, and that means that we need each other, just anthropologically, yes? That we need to cooperate. Yeah? You have these skills, I have these skills, and we can then exchange this. And then we are already very close to why we as human beings do have an economy, and why animals don't. And that there is indeed something quite unique among human beings. The difference of talents, which are not even genetic. Sometimes, you may have, you see in children a certain skill emerging and say, well, I don't know how it ever emerged there. And I don't have it, my wife doesn't have it, the grandparents don't have it, and look here, it is there, yes. Sometimes, of course, you see certain heredity in there, it's, well, it's from one generation to another, but sometimes not, yes. Okay, there's our cooperativity, we need to cooperate each other. Why? Because that is the beautiful thing. I may not be very musical myself, but if others are, I can listen to it. I can enjoy what others are doing. And I may be very good at text forms, and I go to the musician and say, well, can I help you? And then you give a concert to my birthday party or whatever you come to. Play the nice serenade for the violin or for my for the girl I love or whatever. That is the, well, that you can organize these kind of things. Yet one does this, the other does that. Yes, and that's exactly what the same philosopher Althusius says when he continues the sad story about our helplessness and the baby who cannot even walk, cannot even reach the best of the mother by itself. So well. As an aid and a remedy for this state of affairs is offered to the human being a symbiotic life, and he is led, the life together, and he is led, almost impelled, to embrace this life together, the symbiotic life, if he wants to live comfortably and well, even if he merely wants to live. Yes, we need each other. Yes. And the symbiotes, the people who are living together, you use this term symbiotes, therefore, are co-workers who, by the bond of an associating and uniting agreement, communicate among themselves whatever is appropriate for a comfortable life of soul and body. In other words, they are participants or partners in a common life. Yeah. So, instead of being on your own, we have the community in which we cooperate. Well, that is are the key elements of, you could say, a very simple, rudimentary anthropology in the comparison with animals there. Although it is not totally black and white, you see some division of labor among some animals, and could talk about it, but in general, this story holds. There's one thing that is still lacking and that we need to talk about as well, that is a special ability that kind of is necessary when we indeed want to come to this exchange. And that is the fourth part, our ability. This is very simple, but to value things. To say, hey, you are playing beautiful there. I see you there on the, I listen to your flute, what you are the violin. That's really beautiful. Yes. I need to paint my my house, and you can do that. That's very handy for me that you have these kind of skills. Yeah. So recognition is very important for among human beings, that you say, well, this is nice what you are doing there. Yes. And I value that. Yes. So giving compliments is very crucial there. Well, we execute our skills, what we are doing there, and sometimes money. Yes, we can really use money for that to express our admiration for what another is doing. Yeah. And then I think we are close to what anthropologically speaking, why we do have an economy. Yes. Our helplessness, plural creativity, our cooperation, the division of labor, you can specialize in one thing or another thing, and we can give admiration, honor, recognition for each other, to say, well, and value that, what you are doing. So why do we actually work? Why do we have an economy? Well, on an anthropological basis, you can say, to mutually serve each other with our valued creativity. That is basically why you can, why we have it. So what economy is about, when I was in high school, I had to do a book by Professor Heertje, de kern van de economie, what is economy all about, yes. And then this was not said there, yes. It should have been there, I think. Mutual service, actually, with an eye to shared joy. That is actually, well, we can make life much nicer together for each other, because we can then share in each other's abilities, yes, and skills. So, well, we can further think about what then are we doing, the different types of activities that we are doing as human beings, in which basically we all do a little bit of similar things, but we can as well specialize in one of these things. Philosopher Hannah Arendt talks about labor, work, and action, and she has, but I think that is, yeah, I come with a slightly different rubric, so to say. I think caring is very important for us, as a sustaining life, getting food, making food. You can, everybody has to provide for it, and has to make a meal or whatever. But some people can specialize in it, and become a farmer and or in a restaurant or whatever. Yes, what I call embedding life, creating a caring environment for each other. Yes, really caring in a more specific sense, giving house and shelter again for each of us necessary. But you can specialize in that, and then you can work in healthcare and elderly care and whatever, or psychological, psychiatric care, whatever. Yes. Educating about life, next generation, to involve them and to show them how life is done, etc. So passing on, we all do in some way or the other, yes. But you can specialize in that, education. So that's caring. The next couple of activities I would call creating, co-creating, together with others. We can talk about technology, making life more comfortable, and it can, being technological beings goes back millennia, but continues until today, until the smartphones or whatever, making life more comfortable, technology. The ornamentation of life. Art is in all kinds of different things. We all tend to make life more, a little bit more beautiful, to spend some time even on selecting of clothes. I'm pretty sure that nobody here this afternoon, 60, 70 people, has exactly the same clothes. That's, again, a miracle. Yeah, you kind of, well, this is something that you make life a little bit more beautiful. You choose the clothing that you, but others then are making it, of course. That's a simple form of art, but you can as well do all kind of more sophisticated there. And exploring the mysteries of life. Yes. And for me, science and religion are closely related in this. Understanding, trying to understand what the world is, where it comes from, how it goes, etc., how it works. That is co-creating. And then there's a third category, and usually people who are involved, who are specializing in these categories, are thinking that they are very, very important for themselves. And I would doubt this, actually, but that is some of the things that you can talk about. Caring, co-creating, so that are, the, I think, are crucial things in life. But it has to be facilitated as well. You have to organize certain things. So the governance of life, politics, management, organization. Facilitating, not that important, but usually, well, people who are involved in that, they think that a little bit differently about this. But anthropologically, I would say, well, be a little bit more human there, more, how do we say, more humility there. And crediting life goes back already, for thousands of years, somehow dealing certain things with the longer short-term and short-term, making exchange indeed between people possible, etc. So you can use it as a kind of idea about what human beings are doing, caring, co-creating and facilitating. This on the basis of anthropology, we can say this is how we, why we work, and we can talk about it as the homo cooperans, yeah, cooperative human beings. Now comes the historical part, and it's all a little bit the sad part. What has come of this, you could say, cooperative makeup of human beings, and why they have an economy? What has happened with economy through history? Yes. And here I just involve, I'm just dwelling into big history for just for a while. And we usually, when we now, historians, archaeologists, evolutionary biologists, etc., are talking about world history, then they use this kind of division of world history. Say, well, basically, when we're talking about Homo sapiens, then we're talking about, well, some would say 60,000 years ago, others would say 150,000 years ago, that Homo sapiens came, you can say, along and it was developed. But much of the time we were living as hunter-gatherers. Yes. The greatest part of human history, hunter-gatherers. Yes. Just wandering around and see where you can find food, and there you eat it, or you hunt deers, etc. Then from 12,000 before Christ, you see that there are certain places, especially in what we today call the Middle East, was very fertile there at the time. People would stay there, and sedentary life was starting to emerge. From 6,000 years before Christ, we see a lot of traces of, in these places, of agriculture. Say, well, okay, not just living from what nature gives, but we can help nature a little bit by growing corn or later on rice or whatever, agriculture. And then you see, when you have agriculture, means that you have a certain amount of land, and then your harvest may be good, and harvest was, elsewhere may be good as well, or may not be as good. Yes, and then the people who say, well, we don't have enough, probably, but we can take it from there. Yes, so you get a kind of new dynamics there, which is called territorial wars. Yes, and what you need to do then is to have a military. Yes. To defend yourself, or to make it to attack the others. Yes. So, and that to organize that, and eventually you get kings, and you get empires. Yes. So from 3500 before Christ, you see empires. Yes. And that is a curious development that has been almost independently in various places in the world. You see this happening. In the Middle East, the oldest one is the Sumerian Empire of 3500 before Christ. But later on you see it in China, empires, in Egypt, Egyptian Empire. And when you say, well, perhaps historically some part of humanity have developed itself entirely, you can say, cut loose from the other parts of humanity in what we today would call North and South America, Middle America. And when Columbus goes there, he would say, well, perhaps they did not know the trick of empire. But no, Columbus goes there, and the Incas, the Aztecs, etc. Empires there, even there. Yes. So the world fills itself with empires, so to say. And that is a kind of curious thing, actually, because today, when economists, Acemoglu and Robinson have written a book recently, Why Nations Fail, and they talk about extractive institutions. Well, empires are extractive institutions, yes? What you get in there is indeed you have the farmers, and they grow, their crops and the corn, etc., and then the surplus kind of is taken away from them, yes, and goes up in the hierarchy, and there people live well and others remain poor. Extractive institutions. Yes. Well, here's a list of empires. It is a really unbelievable how many there are, and they often exist for a long, long time, for centuries, even millennia sometimes. And the whole world, in a way, fills with empires. Yes. And of course, it's beautiful. When you look at it, what they are able to do is really impressive. And yet, yeah, if you look under the surface, what it really, what the costs are in terms of human cost, then you will say, well, this is way, way, way back of way beyond this homo cooperans. Yes. It's really about the oppression of human beings. Yes, only, for example, the Chinese building of the Chinese Wall is, of course, that's beautiful. Yeah, not now, it's closed now, I believe in these days, but perhaps in the next year or so, or perhaps you have been there. And what you don't realize when you walk up there is how much human life involved in building this is. Estimations are that the cost in terms of human life, when 1.5 million people who die building it is, the same holds for a little bit difference there between historians about, well, the building of the pyramids. Some people will say that slavery was very much involved there. Others has recently said, well, perhaps they were kind of just normal employees with a CAO, etc., and they were kind of doing well. Well, there's a difference there between historians. But we know at least one important story, the biblical story, that there was people involved in building all kind of things in Egypt, the people of Israel, who did not really enjoy that, but they were enslaved there, and even went out there, the Exodus story, in the biblical Exodus story. But human cost involved. Here, Rome was built for an important way by slaves, yes, and who did not really, well, it's that important, yes, you could just take slaves everywhere. So, and these, how then do you legitimize yourself and this type of social organization? Well, by claiming as emperor to be divine, and that is what you all the stories are about: divine pharaoh, or divine emperor, or the heavenly mandate, or indeed Augustus, Divus Augustus, etc. The emperors as divine. Yes. So you build stories to kind of make people believe that it is the right order. Yes. And yeah, that's just continued in Europe. Here, in the beautiful buildings. Beautiful to go to Versailles, but Versailles, when it was built, really meant the collapse of the French economy. Yes. It was way too expensive to build this kind of extractive institutions. Yes. Okay, that's the sad part. Yes. That happens in history, yes. And I will continue this later on. That happens until today in different forms. Yes. And yet, that is not the only story that you can tell about human. Well, this is basically the definition of economy and empire. You never find this in any of the books, but this is the reality. Oppression-based organizational structures in which surplus that people create is constantly skimmed off to a small top layer so that they can achieve a quality of life that remains absolutely unattainable for the vast majority of the population. Yes, that is what you often see. Exclusive fund for a top layer, and disdain for work and for the work. Yes. Only the stupid people work. People that are powerless, etc. Yeah. Extractive institutions. Well, that's the kind of sad story. Glimmer of hopeful counter movements. Yes. What we see in world history is that at a certain stage, you see, people say, well, is this the right thing to do? Shouldn't we think about whether this is the way to organize a society? And shouldn't we think about this? And you have in very different places in the world, and the philosopher Carl Jaspers has called this the actual age. Say, Confucius in China, Buddha in India, Zoroaster in Persia, the philosophers in Hellas, in Greek, and the prophet in Israel. Yeah? Asking questions about the good life, asking questions about is indeed the good life that of the emperor who has all the power, etc., or should there be a kind of ethical orientation in life, in which perhaps the idea of human beings as basically equal, who need to cooperate and respect each other, yes, in one or the other way, is kind of reinvigorated, so to say, is reinvented. Yeah. A lot of things could be said about this, but in the West, and if we are now looking for the development of modern economy, then we are talking about the West, who has really been the birth ground of that. There, one of these traits has been very important there. That's the prophets of Israel. Yes, and this, the biblical story has been very important for the Western history. And what goes on there? Well, actually, the biblical story says exactly what I just was talking about. Saying, well, in the Genesis book, there you have people. Adam and Eve are created, kind of equal, living together. Then violence comes in, people starting to kill each other, and they are starting to build empires. And this is famous painting by Pieter Bruegel, the author of the Tower of Babel. You may know that. And that's basically the end of the universal history that is told in the Genesis story. Yes. That's where history is going, to empires. Yes. And then the next chapter is talk about Abraham. Abraham needs to get out of the empire. You have to get out of there and to start to go to somewhere else, something new. Yes. Later on, that repeats itself. I mentioned already Israel in Egypt, other empire, has to get out of there to promised land, something new. What is going to be, don't know, but something else. Yes. That's an important element in later on, when the biblical story starts to be reread in the West, people start to think, is this indeed the good order? Or should we move towards something else? Yes. So the protest against empire really starts to take place. Abraham, Moses, and then you see Jesus, very important, is that Jesus is not a divine emperor, something like that, but is the son of a carpenter, it's craftsman. It's Joseph is a carpenter, still is the protecting saint of the carpenters today. And that has a strong revolutionary potential in a way, is that every human being has, his or her should be there, dignity, inherent dignity, yes, inherent dignity. And that starts the world to think about, well, what does that mean for people who are just ordinary workers. How do you look at this? There is the idea that you say, well, it should be different. Yes? The kingdom of God, there it should be different. Yes? A new empire that is not like the other empires, oppressive, etc. But somehow a different world could be there. Yes? And that gives rise to a lot of tensions in Western history. Western history, you see, and that is already start in the 11th century when they start to read the biblical stories, etc. Then you get protests, and search for new communities. Yes, our cities, medieval cities, they have a kind of in the background. There is a lot of idea about this should be different from the feudal lords and from the kings, etc. We live here in a different way, a different mode to get. Yes. Farmers, there have been various farmers uprisings. A very famous one was there in 1381 in London, in England. And there was a large farm uprising. So they were there, the Malieveld was not in London, but otherwise they could have come to the Malieveld. And they had as a kind of slogan, we are created in the image of Christ, and yet we are treated like animals. So then they said, well, we should be treated with dignity. Yes. So the revolutions from one to the other, and the search for new types of communities, yes, in which you can say ordinary people kind of have dignity and would count. It's a continuous search for a better society. Well, a couple of elements, but very crucial in that is the new emphasis on the value of labor. The human creativity, what they can do. Famous sermon of Leonardo of Pisa was there about the biblical story about the talents. Even every human being has talents, unique talents, and you should kind of develop that in life. Yes, and Luther talked about the work and your calling. Yeah? Today, when we are talking about in Dutch beroep, yes, that is basically thanks to Luther, talking about vocation, beroep, yes, as something that God calls you to do, yes, and therefore is holy. And your just normal work as a farmer or a carpenter or whatever is a kind of holy work. Yes. In this background, and the long story is I have to make short, of course, but we can only against this background, we can understand the work of the great father of the modern economy, Adam Smith, who indeed says as well, economy should not be about kings, about royal houses, etc. That was what economists before him were arguing. But he says economy should be about ordinary people. So actually the title, The Wealth of Nations, of his book should be The Wealth of Peoples. And that's how he starts. And everybody should work. And everybody can work. And that is how you can contribute. And then you're going to exchange the results of your work. That's the market. Yes. And then we can all flourish. We can all profit from that. Yes, from each other's talents, actually. So out of this background comes a new idea of economy as a way of dignifying human beings in their work and escaping from oppression and poverty. Yes. And that has been, you could say, the large project of the last 200 years to kind of get away from the long history, world history of oppression, to start with something in which we can all participate and all can profit and all can develop ourselves. Yes. This project is it has kind of world historic significance, you could say, 200 years, in which there have been incredible results as well. So if you draw up a balance sheet, then of course there have been big ups and downs, but in as a whole, yes, there are impressive results against in the struggle against poverty and oppression there. And we have the life circumstances of people have gone up incredibly, and 500 years ago, even then, we could not have imagined the level of wealth that is created today. An immense outburst of creativity, very different types of jobs, all kind of people are doing things that even our grandparents would have thought that these kind of jobs would exist, yes, and yet people say, well, I find fulfillment in this, this is important, outburst of creativity, reduction of extraction, yes, growth of peace that has already been in the 18th century, so, well, when people are starting to trade with each other, their relations improve too, yes. So this is a kind of the plus side of this economic revolution of the last 200 years. Plus side. However, I have still one more sheet with pluses. And there's even when I grew up in the 70s and became kind of politically aware, there was 4.5 billion people there, of which 1.5 were structurally undernourished. Yes. You could not imagine the world population growing. It would be just disastrous. Yes. And now we are here with 7.3 billion people. And the number of people who are structurally undernourished has gone down below, still somewhere around 900 million, so below the 1 billion. In absolute numbers, and in percentage-wise has dropped dramatically. still large, of course, but still where that is a problem has much to do with political problems, and much less with that the Earth is not going, not giving enough. Yes. So, incredible, actually. Yes. Availability of consumer goods, yeah, increasingly worldwide. Yes, it is really amazing the kind of growth that we have been experiencing just in the recent decades. Even redistribution of labor takes place. Yes, all kind of jobs. Well, they have moved. Yeah, and the labor unions are very angry about it. But I once got a student from India, and the first thing he said to me when I got took him from the airport was, "Thank you for all the nice jobs that we are getting from you." Well, that's not how we are talking about it. But okay, there is a kind of redistribution going on via the market, yes, and jobs are there in other parts of the world. So, and new types of jobs I mentioned already. So there are plus sides, yes. And yet, I think that is what may happen, and what often happens in human history, is what I can call involution. And involution, evolution is that you have a kind of further development along the way. Involution is that while you are developing, your development is kind of turning against you. And anthropologists are talking about that. They have an example of people who are living in Mentawai, one of the islands in Indonesia. And they kind of were organizing their world in such a way, with kind of giving taboos there, and you could not touch this, you could not touch this, and etc., that they could not live any further in their own world. Yes. So that made life impossible. And it may well be that that was the same thing with empires already much earlier. Yes. They had to defend your territory, etc. And yet they became oppressive. Yes. So it may be that the way we have organized our economy is at that point as well, that you say, well, the involution, that in our strive for a better life, that we are piling up more and more pressure upon ourselves. And in a way, our own inventions may turn against us and make life harder for us. Yes. So that is involution. It may be that we are now at a stage of involution. That we have created something really impressive, and yet it may become oppressive again. Yes. This is a painting of the 20th century painter Francis Bacon, who kind of expresses this experience of involution, I think. Here he kind of lives in his own cube that he apparently has created himself, the person here, and he kind of apparently has created an atmosphere in which he dissolves. Yes. And in which he cannot live anymore, yes, but he cannot escape either. Yes. So, kind of dramatic picture that Bacon is talking about. So the big question actually is that can we continue in the way we have started to do this in the last 200 years? Can we do for another 200 years? Not to mention indefinitely, yes, or perhaps not 100 years. And immediately we say, this is impossible. Yes. Indeed, we have created something. But in that way, continuing, that is impossible. Because we are more and more experiencing what you can say a burnout society. And what that is a burnout society, well, that is, I'm not immediately talking about the psychological part, but about the ecological part. Yes. Of course, this is clear. Yes. The ecological pressure of what we have been doing simply cannot be continued for another 200 years. So we had is a deep redirection is necessary. Ecological pressure, but as well the psychological pressure, sure, is an element of that. I call it psycho-pressure. Yes. More and more, and it's a worldwide phenomenon, we are organizing the economy as a rat race, not as a kind of joyful play in which you do something which I cannot do, and I can do something for you, etc. But more and more, that we need to do to get out first on top of the other, because otherwise we may lose. And people are very much afraid that it is not a kind of organization of solidarity, but it is just an organization of individual success, yeah, and the winners and the losers. Yes. So this idea of the rat race is very important. Which we say, well, If you individually do your best, then you will come out. Just do a little bit, work a little bit harder, earn a little bit more money, buy more things, keep going, and then you will, the happiness is just around the corner. And of course, when you are going around the next corner, then there will be another corner. And say, well, and the next corner, and the next corner. That is the rat race that is organized. You know? In which is exhausting us. You know? Ecological pressure, psycho pressure. Well, you get as well a kind of strange thing that more and more we organize the economy in terms of mathematical models, and the numbers are starting to reign. They are becoming very important in all kinds of things. Even if you're not talking about value, but in terms of value is redefined as price, yes? And the price is considered to be the value. A very interesting book of Marianne Mazzucato about this. And then we come close already to the fourth thing. Indeed, these numbers can be translated in money, the financialization of the economy. Money becomes the key for everything, which is quite recent, actually. The number of, when we started to talk about the economy in terms of gross national product is only since the 1930s in the United States. And has now become a worldwide, you can say, the measure, we'll talk about it later, for the economy. Still, there is a continuation of imperial extraction, north-south, etc., and within countries. And new imperialism comes up, in which a new power concentration and monopolies, especially in the high-tech sector, in which you have large incorporations who now are not talking about are not owning the corn or the food, but are owning data. Yes. In that sense, you get a new entire new power which is almost uncontrolled right now, and a new empire, so to say, of a very different nature than the older ones. Yes. And then there is this depreciation of labor, in the sense that that has been economically, you define labor as cost. Cost you want to reduce, yes. And labor can be important for people, yes, can be part of creativity and service for others, but it's economically it is cost, so you need to reduce it, yes. And then humans are very costly, yes, because they can only work for, well, 8 hours, and then have to sleep, yes, and they're not free, and they have all kind of stories about what they want from their work, etc., and they may rebel, etc., and so, yeah, you can much better replace them by more efficient laborers. Yes, so the tendency toward robotization is, you could say, from an economic logic, almost inescapable. So this, and this is the final part of my talk. We cannot continue. And therefore, we need a new thinking about work and economy in line with the good life, as you could say, is fitting to our being as human beings, anthropologically speaking, which I told in the beginning. Yes, talking about cooperation, co-creation, and working, let's say, on the conditions of good life as a meaningful way of working. Yes. Beyond the burnout society. So, toward an economy of joy, that is the subtitle of my book, we can see a couple of transitions that are, well, on the agenda right now. Of course, this is a very important one. New balance between people and nature, between economy and ecology. It's, of course, that's very much on the agenda now, and there's nothing that is has become commonplace almost, but we need to do it, yes? And there's a lot of, incredible lot of work, because once you are in a certain path, it is very hard to change that path, but it's very urgent. One of the things to do that, and as well to make life more joyful again, maybe the dematerialization of the economy. We'll talk about that later on, but to talk more in the economy in terms of mutual services than in terms of consumer goods, yes? And to somehow curb our the way we have now defined economic production in terms of matter, but in much more in terms of relations. Yes. New the relation between flexibility and security in the labor market. Some proposals recently, but we need to rethink this again. So what do we work for in terms of the entire life, what is important in life? So what is the balance between life, work and private life, between our different activities of creating and caring, etc. So we need to rethink that again. The relation between labor and capital, and that has been one of the important driving powers behind the development in the recent decades, especially the entire role of capital that wants to have more and more is oriented towards short-term maximization of profits instead of value, really creating value. Yes. So the relation between labor and capital needs to be rethought and redesigned, and much more in terms not of shareholder value but of stakeholder value. And, well, I could talk about it longer, but companies themselves, work is a cooperative endeavor. Yes. That implies as well that you somehow have to organize work in a cooperative way. And I think in order to counter, and it has been developed several times in history, to counter, you can say, the oppressive structures, the power of cooperation and cooperative organizational structures is a huge reservoir for new structure of our economy. And final thing is new arithmetic, you could say, a new way of measuring things, a new art of measurement has been starting already, although say hesitantly. When we are talking about, I mentioned just the gross domestic product, yes. More and more, OECD is doing that with the Better Life Index. In the Netherlands, we are working with het bredere welvaartsbegrip. Bhutan is working with gross national happiness. There are all kinds of things are developed to say, well, we should not simply have this one measure of financial measure, but much more ask the question, well, is this really promoting the good life in a more broader sense than simply, we have 2% or 3% economic growth? No, are we doing better in a general way? So that means a new way of measuring, you can both nationally, but as well for companies. Yeah, more and more we are talking about integrated reporting, in which several dimensions of whether a company does good, does really add value, or perhaps destroys value. These kind of questions are there. So these are kind of transformations, and there are more, but I think these are very much urgently on the agenda. If we are talking about this, this 200 years of kind of economic revolution in which we kind of have been able for the first time to escape from poverty and oppression, but we cannot continue in the way we have, the recipe that has worked for now cannot be continued, and we need to find new directions in order to find the flourishing life. This is a medieval fresco which you, if you go to the city palace in Siena, you will find this very beautifully done, in which you say, well, if you organize things well, then human life can flourish. Yes, and you see people dancing, they're working, building their baking, the market transactions take place, even in harmony, the entire fresco has this, with nature, agricultural life, and the countryside, so the city and the countryside in harmony. These are old images of a better life, I think, which we should, again, just articulate and see, well, what is necessary to perhaps not realize it fully, but to make steps toward it. That was it, I think. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Robert Buijs, for your interesting lecture. I think there might be questions from the audience. I will start with a question. Professor Robert Buijs, you have a lecture on why do we work so hard. You lecture in two different universities. You are chairman here and there. Why do you work so hard?
Yeah, that's a tough one, actually. Yes, I do indeed work quite hard, and that's perhaps why I'm writing about this. Actually, well, what? Why are we organizing this in such a way that a lot of people have the feeling that they are working way too hard, and collectively we are working way too hard? Yes, we are producing so much things. We are producing articles as an academic, which you say, well, will anybody ever read them? Well, don't care, I have to produce them. There's very much emphasis on the production. And why are we doing this? Because we organize this collectively in a certain way. And we could not, and that is, I think, is the, for me, the whole burnout discussion, etc. Then usually what is said is, well, it is your problem. Yes, you should deal with it, and you should, well, why didn't you do more mindfulness? And now you're in burnout, it is your problem and you're guilty about it. No, it is a collective problem. And we should address this collectively and address this in our universities and in our companies, etc. And try to change this. So I try to do that at least, to give a different vocabulary to think about it. And at the VU, we have been starting, I would not say that I'm the one who has triggered that, but parts we have contributed to that. We started to, for this year, for the first time, we abandoned the functioneringsgesprekken, in which we kind of well listed with kind of well insufficient, sufficient, good, very good, excellent, and so I had to do this with my own people who I'm working with, and not the same time, and I was myself, and everybody was kind of judging each other, and now we have just abandoned this and say, well, actually, write something about why are you doing what you are doing and what you would like, what are your dreams, what would you like to achieve with it, and how can we help you to achieve that, but as well align that, of course, with the organization as a whole. I'm not an individual, simply, I'm always working in a team, and etc. So this is an entirely different try to organize this, and I think that's what we need to do. To make this problem into a political problem, so to say, into a collective problem, and not say, well, why didn't you go to a monastery to get a rest? And then you go, and then you go a week to a monastery, and then you really do have the pressure, now I need to rest so that I can work, afterwards I can work as hard as possible. So I think that is just a very unfruitful system. So in the way, I'm caught in the system, I'm in a certain way, but I try to do something about it,
And is there something that we can do on an individual level to help it a little bit towards a joyful economy?
Yeah, on an individual level, I think it is important to ask the question, actually, and that is, for me, is very important as well. You can be very much focused on what you can say, philosopher Alasdair MacIntyre talks about external goods. Yes. You can say the things that somehow are measurable and that are not really have to do intrinsically with your work, but with getting rich, with getting admiration of others, etc. So getting power, all these kind of things. And if that is your motivation for what you are doing, well, then that exhausts you in a way. But if you say, well, what I'm doing, and I'm trying to realize why I'm doing this, and is this really what I would like to do, what I want to do, what I think is really adding value to the life of others, if you ask these kind of questions, and you then have to say no, what I'm doing is not, well, then you should quit and do something else in which you really can have intrinsic joy about what you are doing, I think. And people are often not doing that nowadays. Part of what we now call the Netherlands, the incredibly fast growing group of what we call ZZPers, people who are organizing their own work in this kind of small one person business company. I don't know how to translate ZZP, but I'm just to give that as a kind of the description. But 80% of them is the conscious choice. They say, well, I don't want to be part of that rat race anymore. And I would like to organize my work in a different way. So in a sense, that is happening. But I think that's important to do that. Look for your intrinsic motivation in what you're doing instead of the extrinsic.
Thank you. Are there any questions from the audience?
I was wondering.
You get a microphone.
When you were mentioning the construction of the empire, different kind of empires, I would like to ask you if there were some kind of features that human beings decide to, how empire started. And because at some point you also mentioned maybe an empire that could be non-oppressive, which I thought was also a very weird sentence. If you could elaborate on that, because empires are a kind of a structure organization, and if we are also in an empire right now, to a certain extent. Thanks.
Well, thank you for that question. I think there are two elements. I think I just skipped one, one sheet that I may show for a while. That say, well, actually, what you see in human beings is, well, there is a certain starting point of, well, it seems to be necessary. I told about you have agriculture, you have, you are here in this area, and then. You need to defend that, because otherwise, and already Steven Pinker has written a very large volume on this, that the hunter-gatherers were not very peaceful either, perhaps, so even there. But then you need to defend that, and you get a structure, you get military, people, someone has to be in charge of that, becomes king, etc. So that is easily what you get, and there is always a kind of legitimation for it. Well, indeed, I protect you, and indeed, I may oppress you at the same time, but it's the story of oppression. That's why the people are often making themselves into divine figures, etc. Yes. So that's easily how it starts. But anthropologically, I think you can develop one step further, and that's why on this sheet that you say, well, if we see, look at human beings, then there is this tendency that we have our cooperative nature. Right? We know that we have to live together. Yes, but there is as well a tendency, apparently, that we have this orientation toward dominance. That we see it not as cooperative but as rivals, and that we want to dominate the other. Yes, that we want to be on top of it. Yes, that is as well a tendency, and you can go into the evolutionary biological background of that, etc. But it apparently is as well. So somehow we have to recognize that both are elements in us. Yes. And that is what I see here, that what you see is Confucius, Buddha, philosophers, prophets, etc. They are saying, well, they are making that point, bring it out in the open and say you have to deal with it. So somehow you have to recognize these tendencies and to deal with it. And that's morality. Well, the empires in a way are kind of the embodiment of this dominance idea, and then some people win and others may lose. Human beings, we have to develop our morality to deal with these various tendencies. So there's both an anthropological part of it as well, a kind of historical contingent part. And today you will find the very same thing. Facebook, very interesting. You can say, from one side, you see this is an empire that owns very much data, can control us and all kind of things. Yes, and yet it has this idea of a promise as well. What is exactly the slogan? Connecting the entire world, or something like that, or bringing all people together. Now, something like that is something that's beautiful. Yes. Which every empire does, and there is something to it, yes. And yet, this the involution idea, it can go against you, and that's why you need really to check these powers morally, but as well politically. So that is just, and that's why I think it's very interesting for the whole idea of the regulation of the new empires is now really on the agenda. What can we do about the power of... Well, I don't know who of you have seen, watched Arjen Lubach last Sunday talking about Uber. I really recommend it. Very interesting, the way how these new, what I call new empires, are manifesting themselves. And now the need to somehow check this and to bring this in, to regulate this. And of course, Zuckerberg was yesterday in the European Parliament asking for regulation. People really didn't trust him. Well, I understand that quite well. But these are the issues for that are really on our table now.
Well, thank you for a very interesting lecture. You had a comment about the past 200 years that there was less poverty and oppression, and I was feeling like kind of you felt it like a human success. But I know that in those 200 years we had three great wars, the Great War, World War One, World War Two, where we had massive genocide. And we also had Spanish flu decimating the population. Do you think you also call the new balance between people and nature? They calculated that the world cannot handle more than 10 million people for resources, food. And we will hit that number in 2050. All those people will have the Dutch or American dream of having a job, a house, two cars, a boy and a girl, children. Do you think the war is a part of the success story? Because then we need another war, I think. How do you see that in the involution? Where are we at that point? What do you think about that?
Well, thank you. There's a whole lot of questions that you're asking, with a clear line in that. And let me respond to some of the things there. Indeed, and I think that was in the sheet as well, and I said, well, it is with ups and downs, but overall you see this incredible growth in the last 200 years of that we kind of are escaping from poverty in a way that has been never done before. And increasingly worldwide, you can say it first started in Europe, and then with all kind of this. It was kind of Europe was extracting things from other parts of the world, etc. But basically, there has been a kind of change in the whole development now. That we are now talking about worldwide and incredible development. Yes. And even the world wars in terms of even violence even in the 20th century, the chance that you would be killed by war and violence, by political violence or whatever, is much lower than it has ever been before. So the book of Steven Pinker, and that is very interesting in that sense, that the level of violence really is going down. And so there has been a real progress in certain ways, even when there are deep downs, so it is not just so, it goes in that way. Yeah. But it's very clear what I told, incredible that even the doubling of the population, almost world population from the 70s until now, that can be carried by the Earth. The market has been done, in combination with technology, has been done in incredible lot. Yes. That we cannot continue indefinitely in that way is clear as well. That indeed seems to be kind of, well, as far as our models go, that you can say 10 billion people, that so there's still growth. But there are two things there, and that is the maximum. But as well, the predictions are as well. They say, well, usually when there is a certain level of wealth, then the population tends to stabilize or even go down a little bit. So the number of, the birth numbers in all the more developed countries are going down, even to such an extent that the population will reduce there. So in a way, there seems to be a kind of connection there between, a certain decent amount of decent living conditions and population growth, in the sense that there will be kind of stabilizing there. But of course, it is clear that we should be very, that's why we as well, we should be very, really deal with the future in that way and not let it come over us and see actually, we need to reorganize on a world scale our economy and make it much more balanced. So that has to do with ecological balance, but as well with this kind of the north-south relationships, etc. There is still a lot of work to be done there. So I give a you ask a lot of questions, but I may not have not answered all of your questions. But
Is there maybe one short question left?
I combined two elements in your presentation, which I very much enjoyed. Thank you. Mm-hmm. One was about one of the factors determining the deterioration was the tendency to quantify, to put everything in the numbers. Mm-hmm. And in the beginning, you qualified or you subdivided work into caring mm-hmm. and co-creating. Mm-hmm. And the second point of co-creating, which I think was your favorite because it's your job also, was about exploring the wonders of science and religion,
Religion. The mysteries of the world. Yes,
My idea is that science can be described to a very large extent as trying to put the mystery of life, convert them into numbers. Mm-hmm. And don't you think then that by exploring science, you actually are one of the factors of our own evolution?
Yeah. Well, I wouldn't say so. I wouldn't. No, I think that science has been, and that there is a tension between, you can say, religion and science. It's only very recently that people are constructing this, exploring how the world works is really kind of exploring the mystery of the world and making our awe for the world even greater. And it gives us the opportunity and the possibility if we need to act in the world, to manipulate certain things. And yet, that is very important. That is always the case. Yeah? When people have power to do something, you need morality to counter and to guide it. And if I have a criticism on the developments now, and is that we are increasing our potential to manipulate the world incredibly. Last week I attended a lecture by Robert Dijkgraaf, and I respect him very much, but I really thought this was kind of curious. He said, now in modern science, we have now been spending the last 300 years on discovering and identifying the building blocks of the universe. And now it is time to start playing with the building blocks. And he used the image of Lego. He said, we can do basically everything. Yes. And he was not, only in passing, he was talking about what this means for our morality. Yes. And I think that's very important, is that we think, what do we want to build and what do we not want to build? Yes. And so I do not see an immediate tension that we now are able. You mentioned the Spanish fever, yes. That now we have the coronavirus, yes. But we now know how to contain it a little bit, thanks to science using numbers. Even then it has grown, but we now say should be very careful, and etc. All kind of measures are taken in order to prevent this from making the same disaster as even in my family and the great grandfathers in the family, people dying from the Spanish fever. Yes, that is incredible, and we should be glad for that. But also, we get now in the stage that we are kind of have the opportunity, the capability to, you could say, to use Robert Dijkgraaf's metaphor to rebuild everything. And that is really crucial, that we really have the debate, and that is not only about the economy, but about the development of science as well. What are we going to do here? And yeah, you can have all kind of utopian ideas, you can have all kind of dystopian ideas. Well, it will go terrible, it can go beautiful, etc. Both do not help. I think the real help of what is really necessary is this fundamental moral debate.